culture, everything is permitted.
Welcome to episode 40 of Everything is Permitted here at Wade's Comic Madness. I'm your host, Julian Brown, alongside my co-host, the Man of Steel, Matt Reppert, the Master of Puns, Brittany Tomes. How we doing?
It is a rainy day right now.
It's actually snowing.
Yeah,
is it?
When it lands on you, it is snow, and then it melts immediately.
Oh, when we were walking in, it finally just turned into full-on snow.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Yep. I like snow.
I'm just excited because it reminds me of Hoth. Every time it snows since I was little, I'm like, okay, it's like Hoth outside. Let's go. Where's my Tauntaun?
Getting cut open by Han Solo and that horrible smell. I really wanted to get the Tauntaun sleeping bag when Think Geek was still a thing, and I never got it.
It was always so expensive.
I'm sure you could find it somewhere on the internet.
I'm sure I could. I don't know if I want to go through all the effort and trouble.
But at what cost? Really fucking expensive.
Very expensive. We have a great show for you today. Raiders of the Bargain Bin returns. I know Matt is excited as ever. There's a little bit of, what do you call
controversy?
It? Controversy? Not controversy, but it's not a unanimous decision. Usually we just completely hate on the movie. Mm. This is not the case this time. It's going to be an interesting Raiders of the Bargain. Dissension in the ranks. It's going to be an interesting Raiders of the Bargain Bin. We also will be reviewing episode 3 of The Baby Yoda Show, a.k.a. The Mandalorian.
You know what I just realized? Raiders of the Bargain Bin is also a pun because we rate the Bargain Bin movie. So it's Raiders of the Bargain Bin. You did that without me, Julian. I wasn't even here
actually,
yet.
Actually, that whole thing was Matt. Matt came Matthew. Up with the idea. He came up with the name.
Wait, is your full name Matthew or is it like...
It's Matthew.
Martholomew.
Martholomew would be awesome.
Then my name would be Mart.
That's what I call my cat Martha. So when I went to say...
Why'd you say that? I was about to say, like, we're all about to start making those references, which is topical with today's episode.
It is, because we're going to be talking about Justice League.
Yes.
I just want our listeners to know that we've just been shooting the shit before we even started recording for a good, like, 20 minutes. It's a mood down here.
It was a lot of laughing. We talked about how Game of Thrones is... And American Gods are basically just porn.
Well, no, my take was that Game of Thrones makes boobs boring because it's like they're in there so much. It's like, all right, guys, just can we please advance the plot? Like,
there's some good boobs in Game of Thrones and there's some mad boobs in Game of Thrones. So you know, that's how
did you say mad boobs or bad boobs?
Yeah. M E H meh.
Oh, mad boobs. I thought you said mad.
There
boobs.
Are no bad
I'm
boobs.
I'm picturing the Mad King. no, this boob isn't mad enough.
If you've seen The Shining and if you've seen Dr. Sleep, you know there are some bad boobs out there. Just saying.
Oh, God.
Just saying. It's this kind of mood down here in the Wade's Comic Madness basement today. It was actually a really cool weekend here at Wade's Comic Madness. There was a local
awesome.
Comic book day.
Yeah, local comic shop day happened and there were crazy sales. Almost everything in the store was 30% off unless it was like consignment or something that was super new this week if it was a comic or new this month for gaming. Man, I finished my Christmas shopping here.
Nice.
It was great. I was like, wait.
And then, of course, the Friday before local comic book day, we had our Raiders of the Bargain Bin movie night, which was a little bit smaller than last time. So come out when we do it again, but it was still a blast. Mm-hmm. We had the snacks. We had the Great Wall. We had the Matt Damon.
You guys laughed so hard it sounded like you had a bigger crowd, though.
I did. It did. It was a lot of fun. And we're going to obviously get into that. Also, like Matt mentioned earlier, we are going to be talking about what's been hitting the news and Twitter a lot the past week and a half or so. Hashtag Release the Snyder Cut has really taken up a lot of steam again. We're going to talk all about that. And also some of Henry Cavill's comments about not only Justice League, but his role as the Man of Steel as well. That's also Matt's nickname there. So we have that mm-hmm. coming up. Before we get into everything, we have some announcements to take care of. And we're really excited for this one. We announced it on Facebook, and that is the return of the Great Permitted Rewatch. And this time, it's going to be Star Wars. And we are doing a really awesome contest with it.
This music's hitting my heart.
I love Ray's theme. Yeah, it had to be Ray's theme.
I also love doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. And you're like, ooh, we up to shenanigans.
I still prefer the classic themes, honestly. But
hey, the classic themes are amazing. And I'm really excited about John Williams' score for this because like literally every theme from Star Wars ever is apparently going to be in this movie. So, yeah.
I might as well just close my eyes and listen to the film.
Right, exactly.
I'll do that on first
it
watch.
It is the return of the Great Permitted Rewatch. This time it is the Star Wars edition, and we are doing an awesome contest. We not only are going to be giving away a copy of Jedi Fallen Order for the console of your choice, we've teamed up with our friends here at Wade's for what, Brittany?
Some awesome stuff. I don't remember the Wade's. Was it comics?
Or it was comics. It was an awesome Star Wars comic bundle. So you're probably wondering, how do I get my hands on such awesome loot? Well, starting on, I believe it is Tuesday. Correct me if I'm wrong, guys. I'm going to pull up a calendar. It's either Monday or Tuesday, December 9th.
December 9th is Monday.
Starting on that day, we are going to have you do some old-fashioned decoding. We are going to post a picture on all of our social media accounts of a word in the Star Wars language of Arabesh. It'll be in that language. It won't be English. It'll pertain to the movie of the day. So the 9th will be The Phantom Menace. The 10th will be Attack of the Clones. And you have to translate to us. How do you get us that info? You're going to email us at permittedpod@gmail.com. Again, that's permittedpod@gmail.com. We're going to post these pictures in Arabesh. You're going to translate them and send them to our email. If you send us every single one, you'll be entered to win. And
the,
we will
the
be
translator in me is loving this.
I know. And we're going to do the giveaway, I believe, the Monday after Rise of Skywalker releases. We'll announce the winner. So start learning some Arabesh, download the font, start typing in it, maybe give you a little bit of an advantage. I'm really looking forward to this, not only for the contest, but just to watch Star Wars over and over until Rise of Skywalker comes out.
I don't know. Are you really excited to watch episode 2 and 3 again?
I'm excited to watch episode 3 again. I love episode 3.
Episode 3 is at least like hits you emotionally. 2 is just kind of like, oh dear.
I'm an episode 3 sympathizer. I have nothing really good to say about the first two, but episode 3 I think is a good movie.
Revenge of the Sith sympathizer.
I have a feeling we're going to be throwing down at some point when we talk about episode 3, because I am not an episode 3 apologist.
Well, if it comes up, it all depends on how these come up when we're recording. We're going to post our December episode, you know, what we're going to be talking about in December very soon, and it's going to be very Star Wars heavy. So yeah.
I loved you, Anakin. I hate you.
You were my brother, Anakin.
I have the high ground, Anakin.
I love you, but I will not save you.
Oh, man.
He's alive. Sorry, we're getting so off topic.
That's so fun.
Also, another big announcement. It's going to be the return of
the Golden Gauntlets.
The Golden Gauntlets, the second annual Golden Gauntlets. And we are going to be getting all of our categories out to you to vote on very soon. We're also going to do something special this year and have some guest presenters both record some segments for us, maybe come in and do it live. I believe we're looking at the second weekend of January for those. So we have that to look forward to. Going to be lots of fun.
Yes. Yep, the best rewards this season. Like reward season, you know?
Oh, yes. Sorry.
I just meant like,
right over the head.
I thought you said rewards for a second.
I did too.
Wait, what?
I did too.
Best awards this season.
Yes.
Did I say rewards?
I think you said rewards.
It might have been.
Damn it. Yeah. Let's do it again.
No, it's okay.
We'll do it live.
Another big announcement that I didn't put on here, but I have to remember, is we talked about it, I think, an episode ago. We are going to be doing our second live show. It's going to be for the Rise of Skywalker. It's going to be a Rise of Skywalker review special. We're going to be doing that live. And I believe what we're going to try and do is also see if you've seen the movie. We want to have an audience here and take questions from you and maybe come on and talk about the movie. So we won't only be doing it on Podbean Live. We want to hopefully have an audience. So we'll be getting the event on Facebook up for that very soon. That'll be here at Wade's Comic Madness. And then finally, if you haven't seen it already, the pre-orders are up for our permitted mystery box. We only have a couple of pre-orders. So if you want to get in one of these boxes, I think we are going to stop pre-orders on December 10th. So you want to get in on that very quickly. That'll have an item for myself, Brittany, Matt, and also our West Coast correspondent, Heather. So pre-order those. It's easy. You just fill out a form. We'll invoice you, and we'll send you a box full of random awesome loot.
Yeah.
Yeah, who doesn't love a good mystery box?
I love mystery boxes. It's something I look forward to a lot when I get my Marvel collector core box.
I've never gotten a mystery box from anywhere.
They're a lot of fun.
Mm.
I think they're a lot of fun.
It'll be fun from us.
Yeah, it'll be fun for us to put it together.
It will. Guys, let's get into some rants and raves. Who wants to go first? Brittany.
I have two rants.
Ooh, I like rants.
Hopefully I don't steal one from somebody else. But I saw the Charlie's Angels movie this last week. And it was a pretty good movie. Like, it was fun. Everybody I went with had a good time. Like, that was males and females alike. I don't get where all the hate's from coming from the internet. Well, I do know, so I can't really say that. But I don't know what's wrong with some people out there, but going and not even seeing the movie, but immediately down, like, rating it or giving them these horrible reviews, like, makes no sense because, like, you obviously didn't see the movie. You haven't referenced anything from the film that actually would make sense to critique. And it's just kind of like, oh, I'm sick of reboots and I'm sick of seeing, like, feminism and, you know, all this, like, SJW crap. And I'm just like, dude, it was a feminist film. It's about, like, three female spies that really enjoy their jobs that they do, and they're really fucking good at it. Like, that's the point of Charlie's Angels. The original show in the 70s was feminist. That was the point. Like, the 2000s films were campy, but they were still feminist. Like, but this took it a step further and was like, it was actually a good film. I give it a 7 out of 10. It's not perfect, and it's not like I'm claiming it to be a perfect film.
Well, also, like, really, who was this movie made for?
It was made for
like,
women.
Exactly. So, shut the fuck up, macho douchebag dudes.
Yeah, like, and then, it's not like, for you. Elizabeth Banks tried to defend herself, at least being like, you know, my movie doesn't deserve this criticism or this hate, and, like, people are only hating on it for these reasons. And then, like, it's sad, but even seeing on Facebook, like, these different, like, nerd groups, like, post about it and share those stories over and over again, I'm just kind of like, you're perpetuating it in your own group. Like, we haven't shared anything about it, and the most I said was just that I enjoyed the film.
You should make one of, like, what we've been doing with the reviews, like, put a quote. Did you?
I will put a quote. Yeah, you should. I think I did on my own Facebook, but I will share it. So, overall, I just think, like, if you're not going to go see the film, don't give it different ratings or, like, critique it if you're not even willing to go see it to give an actual review. And on top of that, like, just let people enjoy films. Like, I know there's films that I like or don't like, but, like, at the same time, if somebody really enjoyed Midway, that's fine. I'm not going to be horrible to them, you know?
But, like, I don't know. I might be horrible to them.
But, like,
I don't know.
Compared to, I mean, especially Midway, I was just like, you know what? Like, that objectively just wasn't a good film. This one, at least, I could see why it's enjoyable for people. Like, I don't know. It didn't deserve the critique and the horrible crap it's getting.
I mean, I want to see it.
So it's just sexism. Yeah. That it just comes down to that.
Like, I'm not interested in seeing it, but I would never be like, this movie sucks because there are three whores that just go out and do
it. Yeah, exactly.
Like, I think it did so poorly also because the marketing was just bad.
Yeah.
I wanted to go see it, and I didn't even know the day it came out until I went to look up tickets for it because I happened to watch one of the older Charlie's Angels movies. Mm-hmm. And then I realized, oh, no, it's already out. So then me and my brother and, like, cousin and stuff went to go see it. But all of us were like, I don't remember the last time I saw a trailer for this or, like, when it was coming out.
That's the problem with a few movies that have come out recently. Like, mm-hmm. Terminator had that issue, and apparently, you know, it did get good reviews. I still think the franchise needs to die a big fiery death, but just me.
But the Terminator never dies a big fiery death, really.
He got melted in the second one.
He always comes back.
Maybe he shouldn't this time, just saying.
Like James Cameron, he always comes back.
That's a whole other controversy that I don't think I put anything about in the permitted minute. Matt, did you have a rant or rave?
So I will rant a little bit. I actually am going to rant against licenses and exclusive licenses and video games. So before my Gamers Club expired at Best Buy, I purchased FIFA 20, which, it's not bad. The gameplay is actually kind of fun and everything like that. However, if you don't own it or you hadn't heard about this, first of all, the club Juventus is not in the game. They are not in the game because Juventus apparently signed an exclusive licensing agreement with Konami, so they are in Pro Evolution Soccer. So all of the players are in there, but they basically made up a club that has Juventus's black and white kits, their colors, a similar-ish.
I have to do something here real quick, Matt, for EA Sports. Okay.
Get your shit together.
I feel like that's our most used button.
It's a good button, and it's worthy, I think, in this situation. What a joke.
Yeah, but the thing is, though, is that I don't think this was EA. I think this was Juventus.
Really?
This was Juventus that went to Konami, or Konami went to them and said, hey, we want you to be exclusively in our game.
You know what's ironic?
What?
Wasn't EA Sports tagline like, it's in the game?
Apparently,
but Juventus is not.
Apparently not.
Apparently not.
But, like, it's because I remember for, like, I started playing the game and I'm, like, messing around in career mode because I never do that ultimate team crap. And I'm, like, and I kind of cheat a little bit because I go to websites and I look up, like, all right, who might be a good player in a few years? And I try and sign them to my team. And there were, like, a couple players that were on. It was, like, I forget the name of the team, but it was, like, I forget what they call it, Juventus, in the game. But there was this team and I didn't recognize them. And I was, like, who the hell is this team? Like, who are these people? Like they seem to have all these good players. I've never heard of them. And I'm like, wait, Ronaldo? And I'm like, oh, no. And that's when it hit me. I'm like, this is Juventus. Like, this is the team that they made up.
No, this is Nuventus.
Oh, man, you totally just broke my chain of thought. I was going to say something. Oh, yeah. I've decided that I'm not going to buy another FIFA game until every MLS stadium is in there. I'm very happy with FIFA 19.
They're slowly working on, because a lot of the, like, I know obviously all of the Premier League stadiums are in there. They've actually started quite a few of the La Liga stadiums in there.
Ooh. And I mean, there's some MLS ones that keep getting in there. I think they added
Atlanta and Seattle are in there.
And Atlanta, and Seattle, and Atlanta, and
I think Vancouver was.
And Vancouver, they still are, because they make the game from the EA Sports Vancouver.
I won't play until the Union's in there. Like the Union stadium. Like the stadium. Yeah.
I'm legit surprised that they just haven't sold stadium packs as like DLC.
Talking about what we were talking about in the Streaming Wars Part 2, not the Streaming Wars Part 2, DLC not included, Games as a Service, that is a DLC pack I would 100% buy.
Capitalize on the fans, man.
The only reason I think that they haven't done it for a lot of stadiums, like for example, for Talon Energy Stadium, one of the biggest parts of it is the bridge in the background, and is there licensing that has to be done for that bridge to be there and things
like
that?
Here's a wicked big throwback, okay? PS3 2014 FIFA World Cup game had a generic version of Talon Energy Stadium in it. So it had the bridge in the background, but instead of being how it's like, it had the Commodore Barry, but you know how it like tips off at the point?
Yeah.
Instead, it was just a curved bridge. So maybe that was it. But Talon Energy Stadium, or the then PPL Park, was in the 2014 FIFA World Cup game.
I think that's the last time I was there. It was PPL Park.
Yeah.
It's still that.
We got to get you to games this season, by the way.
I went to like one Union game there. It was like earlier, and when like maybe 2 years after they became a team. And
I've been to all the U.S. women's game there too. They're a lot of fun there.
Yes, queen.
Yeah. I have a rant and a rave. I'm going to start with my rave. My rave is that I didn't post anything about it on Facebook yet, and I will post a quote and a trailer for it. If you haven't gotten a chance to go see Ford vs. Ferrari yet, go see it. It's not my film of the year. Well, yeah, I don't think it's my film of the year, but it's damn good. And I think Christian Bale deserves a Best Actor nod for it. And he probably will, or Best Supporting. Matt Damon was also almost unrecognizable in his voice acting, just the way he did the role as, I forget his first name, but
Carroll Shelby.
Carroll Shelby, yep. You know, if you love cars, the Mustang Shelby Edition is like one of my favorite cars ever. You know, just a really great movie, really tense, kind of a sad story. You were talking about it. Go see Ford vs. Ferrari. Absolutely fantastic. Rant time. Walmart. We got some issues.
Oh my God.
We got some. So intense. We got some. Yeah, it's going to get intense. I went to Walmart yesterday to go pick up all our, on Friday, our candy and soda for Bargain Bin movie night.
Yeah.
And before I had done that, I had been on IGN, who every day posts their daily deals, and they've been making lists of Black Friday deals. And some stores, like Walmart, are doing early Black Friday deals. One of them was for Apple AirPods. Now, I have what I'm wearing right now, my over-the-ear headphones. I use these for editing. This is what I bring on like when we go to California to see the in-laws. I like having small headphones. Caleb tends to grab at these a lot. I need something, you know, small and wireless as well. So they were like $60 off. They're going to be like $70 off on Black Friday. But I was like, they're $60 off now. I'm just going to get them now. So every single store in our area, our Walmart store, had them in stock, like in ready for pickup today. So I go and there's like store managers in the electronics section, like in their suits, which you don't see at Walmart. I was like, I'm looking for the AirPods. He's like, oh yeah, someone's going to get them at a lockup for you right now. They look and look and look. They're like, well, they're not here. We're sold out. And I'm like, but your app says you have them right now. And they're like, well, the app's not always reliable. I'm like, but every single store says you have them in stock. So something's not computing. Like I could literally do a store pickup right now and get them.
That's
like they're in stock.
I've actually done that where it's like, oh, I don't have any. Like, well, hang on a second.
Yeah.
And I put the order in. It's like, oh, you better find it.
But what proceeded to happen next was so damn sketchy. It made me so mad. So I decided to talk to someone else because I didn't believe them. And while they're talking, I overhear someone said, oh yeah, we took those all out of lockup and they're in the back. You can't sell any until Black Friday.
Oh.
To which I said, that's BS. And another woman came in looking for another piece of electronics that was on sale and was also told the same thing. And she's like, I'm a manager at another store, and I know that you guys aren't allowed to do that. So I don't know if she got her thing, but I had it with like two employees. I was like, I know that if I hit purchase right now for store pickup that you're going to be able to, I'm going to be able to pick these up in like 2 hours. She's like, no, I'll get the order and it's going to bounce back to me and I'll have to cancel it. I'm like, well, let's see what, I said, let's see what happens. Boom. I did what you said, Matt. Mm-hmm. I hit order 2 hours later. Mm-hmm. Your order is ready for pickup.
I got a funny, funny mention that because Heather lost one of her AirPods and she wants another one for Christmas. So I might be running over there.
Don't run over there because they won't give them to you. Do a store pickup.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah.
I was so fucking pissed because like I'm trying to give you my money. Like yeah. $140
That,
like, bucks.
Literally makes no sense
like,
to me.
Like I'm trying to give you money. The fact that they made me go through the ringer and made me come back to the store when I was already running late to our event, or at least in my opinion, running late because I like to get things set up early, was infuriating. Like, screw you, Walmart. Screw you. If that is everything, it is time for
the permitted minute.
The permitted minute.
The permitted minute. And we are going to go here in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Mr. Gatiss, start the clock.
Rejoice, you will.
Baby Yoda merchandise will be available in time for the holidays.
The upcoming Black Adam film starring Dwayne Johnson will introduce the Justice Society of America to the big screen. The supergroup has previously shown up on CW's Legends of Tomorrow. Despite all the news to the reporting to the contrary, Todd Phillips has said there is no contract for a Joker sequel, despite the film being the first rated R movie to reach $1 billion. This is why we don't post these rumors until the suits have spoken.
Stargirl has been announced for the DC Universe streaming service. The show will also air on the CW days after the episode airs on DC.
On the subject of the Snyder Cut, Joss Whedon reshot a total of 80 script pages, which DC ordered him to do.
Kathleen Kennedy came under some scrutiny this week as she said there is, quote, no comics, no novels when it came to material to use for the latest trilogy as well as future films. Apparently, she doesn't remember launching Order 66 on the expanded universe.
The Lucasfilm president also said that Kevin Feige's Star Wars film is still a ways away. Holy crap.
What?
1 minute exactly.
Yeah.
Isn't that like the third or fourth?
We've been cutting it close. Like, we've been cutting exactly. It close.
And some of these are lengthy. So.
They were. I thought we were going to, I didn't think we were going to do it this time.
Some of them are chunky boys.
They are chunky boys.
Hashtag
sometimes
they thick with two C's.
Oh, Lord, he coming.
Sometimes, girl, are you thicker than a bowl of oatmeal?
Thicker than some thick cut smoked bacon.
Oh, I like,
you
know, bacon.
I love bacon.
You know, by the way, Julian, going back to your rant real quick, it's funny you mentioned, like, you know, your store says, your site says you have them, but, you know, where are they? Is I went through that picking this up.
For at Best Buy, right?
I drove to another Best Buy.
Yeah.
I drove to the Princeton one because our Best Buy was like, oh, I'm like, well, your store says, well, sometimes the thing doesn't update, which tells me that an employee probably grabbed the one or two that they had and threw it aside, mm-hmm. and, you know, and is trying to buy it themselves.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah. Which is just like some of the practices that these companies, you know,
shady.
It's so shady and it's so sketch. Like, come on.
I wouldn't be surprised if they're like selling on the side too.
Do you remember when I had this issue with GameStop and they had Funkos that I needed to buy and they were holding them for their regulars and I reported them to regional?
Holding Funkos hostage.
Yeah.
Not in front of Julian Brown, our Funko hero.
Tonight on Dateline.
Some NFL referee runs and blows a whistle and like, holding Funkos.
Oh, man.
They're Funkoing, going, gone.
Oh, I love God. You guys. Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, Jesus.
I guess we're a Funk group. That was bad. I did well the last three times.
It was forced. It was forced.
It was a little forced.
Forced, almost like the Fallen Order.
Mother of God.
That was a little bit delayed, but worth it.
It's okay.
All right, guys. Let's get to...
Oh, that's like The Last of Us Part 2. Delayed, but worth it.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Guys, let's get into our Mandalorian Chapter 3 review. And this might have been the best episode of the series so far.
Can we appreciate that it did exactly what we all said it needed to do?
It did. It did.
I'm having fun. I love the show.
It is so good.
Yeah, it's definitely a fun show.
That's it? That's it, Matt? It's just a fun show?
No, I like I was just kind of tacking on to you guys, assholes.
I'm Jesus.
God damn.
He didn't know if we were really reviewing yet. He's like, yes, it's great.
Yes, it's excellent.
It's just a fun show.
Before we get into, you know, our round robin of thoughts here, I think we can all agree that this is probably the most Star Wars-y episode of the show so far.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I do like is that it kind of is starting to touch upon the Mandalorian culture, so
which we really haven't seen since Clone Wars, the series.
Rebels. Although, as somebody did point this out, like, where did this whole thing of they never moved their helmets come from? Because in Rebels, they had their helmets off all the freaking time.
That's actually, I have an answer to that question. I thought you might ask that of because course. You picked these things apart. Mm. So, if you remember in the Clone Wars, how they talked about the Mandalorian culture before they went pacifist, and it was deeply ingrained and enriched, that culture never took their helmets off. It was sacrilege, and then they went to
survival.
Yeah, exactly.
Of the fittest.
And then they went to become a pacifist planet / race, whatever you want to call them. And then, you know, as you know, Mandalore was sieged again, and they had to kind of spread out. And that's what you see on Rebels. That hadn't, you know, really. They hadn't gotten back to their more ritualistic ways yet. From what I'm getting from The Mandalorian, which is now, you know, 5 years post Empire, that it is that they have been cut down in size quite a bit. Like, there's not a lot of them left, and that they've gone back to that, like, you know, ancient, like, ritualistic way of, like, we are all about the survival of our people, about our rituals, about our armor, about keeping our helmets on and never showing our faces. So I think that is the big answer there.
Well, we'll see. Yeah.
We will see. I'm curious if we will see Pedro Pascal's face at all. We saw him a lot in the Great Wall.
Will he have the chin strap?
Will he have
in the Mandalorian if he removes his helmet?
We will see indeed. But a wonderful episode as we're three chapters in. Brittany, your initial thoughts on chapter 3?
Oh, man. I was just, like, really pleasantly surprised by a lot of things that happened in the episode. Like, not surprised because it's literally what I said and thought was going to happen, but when it did, it felt really fulfilling, if that made any sense.
Yeah.
So, you're like, man, I hope he betrays them and goes back for Baby Yoda. Boom. Happens. Man, I really hope the other Mandalorian show up. Boom. Yeah. And they were, like, really great scenes, too. So, oh, I loved it. I love the action, too. So good.
Yeah, it was great action, and even though, like, you knew the beats were coming, like, a mile away, like, as soon as he gave up Baby Yoda, it was like, it's just a matter of time until he goes back, because the show is not just gonna, like, all right, Baby Yoda's gone, he's gonna do other stuff now.
Like, too heart-wrenching.
For a minute, I honestly didn't think that he was, after he took them, like, I thought that the he money. Wouldn't take the money, but he took the money, and I was like, oh, man, this is gonna be that kind of
show.
Best
part, when they handed the money, and it was in that weird ice cream machine looking thing, which is a throwback to the original trilogy. Oh man, that's great.
Matt,
Row Hood.
Yeah, your initial thoughts.
No, even though, like, I saw all the beats of the entire episode coming a mile away, as Brittany said, when they happened, it was very satisfying. Like,
struck a chord, those beats.
Him going back,
not
and,
giving you anything.
And I did like the fact that you saw a little bit more of his character, like him, like, unscrewing the top of the throttle and giving it to Baby Yoda, who was playing with it earlier. Yeah.
That's so wholesome. Even that scene when he goes to take off in the ship and he goes to use that
and
piece.
And it's not there.
And it's not there. Like, you see so much of his acting without, like, obviously without the helmet being off, that I think they'll never take it off because he does it so well.
The closest comparison, I think I said it while we were watching it, is V for Vendetta, which, yes. I mean, was such great acting where I could almost see his face the entire movie, even though you never saw it. So.
Yeah.
So good.
For me, like, you know, I said earlier, this was the most, like, Star Wars episode of the show. I did love that we're getting into, you know, some more of the lore of the Mandalorian people. It's one of my favorite things. Sabine Wren is one of my favorite characters in Star Wars. I really like that scene where they're calling him, his fellow Mandalorians are calling him a coward for a second, and they get in that big fight, and then their chieftain is basically like, what are you doing?
Yeah, she's like, okay,
they let them fight, but, like, this is not what we do. Like, and then that line.
And the vibroblades.
The vibroblades.
I can't even talk. Yeah.
Which we said would show up in the show. They did. Yes. And then she goes, like, this is the way. And they all fall in line and they all go, this is the way. And it was just, like, such a cool moment. And what reinforced that for me, and one of my, you know, probably my favorite episode, my favorite part of the episode, was when the guy that he got in a fight with completely backs him up when all the Mandalorians come to protect him.
Talk about ride or
while
die.
He's trying to, you know, get out of there with Baby Yoda, because he does rescue him. And then, even though it was cheesy as hell, when he's flying off and he comes up and salutes him, I'm like, this is the way.
Exactly.
This is Mandalore. It's about us first. It's about the survival of our people first, no matter what.
Mandalorians versus the galaxy.
Yeah. Ride or die, bitch. Ride or die.
No, I loved when they all appeared and they were all using their jetpacks, and he was just like, need to get one of those.
Yeah.
I got to get one of those.
And the fact that he's slowly accumulating more of the weapons, because we saw that he was using the whistling birds.
The whistling birds were so cool. Yep.
Oh, yeah, so cool. And then like she also was like, "Oh, how did you like? What did you have to do to get this?" And he was like, "Oh, it took down like a mud horn." And she's like, "Oh, well, that'll be your signet." And he's like, "Well, I didn't do it honorably.
It wasn't a clean kill.
It wasn't honorably. So I had help and blah 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 blah." And she's like, "All right, whatever." Yeah. And like,
I love how understanding they are and how they like it's a big part of their culture. So obviously she's like, "Okay, well, it's not an honorable kill, so I get why you turn this down."
Yep.
It wasn't like she was forcing it on him, or it shows a lot about his character that he wasn't like, "Oh, I could get this really cool like." Mm-hmm. Yeah, signet on me, but no.
That scene too, when he walks in to get another bounty after he's gotten his armor and he's all shiny, and what's his name? Apollo Creed is like, they all hate you,
Carl Weathers.
They all hate you, Mandalorian, but I don't.
Yeah, he's like, I don't do another job for me.
Yep.
Yeah. Top 10 anime betrayals.
This episode was just fantastic. I want to get into kind of what do we think, you know, we're going into episode 4 next Friday. Where does it go from here now? Is he going to get hunted down?
So I like they basically took a page from John Wick 2 where literally everybody's bounty thing starts going off. Now that's either because there's now a bounty on him or because the baby is now back on the table because mm-hmm. now they're like, we want the baby. So they might still have those trackers that they initially had because it was established that like everybody pretty much got hired for this and nobody could do it but him.
Or why not both? Also, were they scanning little baby Yoda for his midichlorians? They were like low-key hinting, but I was just like, say it, say midichlorian.
I really hope not.
There's no way they're going to.
Brittany, how about you? What do you think? Where do you think we're going from here?
I think it's going to be Death Stranding in space. Literally, you got the Mandalorian and a baby, and they are just trekking.
So where are the Death Stranding out in space, then?
They're called Death Troopers, first of all. No, I'm just kidding.
Empire's kind of gone there, Brittany.
I know. I don't know. Either way, I like how it's kind of like a typic like old Western film where it's just like, okay, you got what you got to do, but now the world's open.
Yeah.
So like, where are you going next? What's your next plan? Is he going to keep trying to do bounties while having a baby at
his You got side? All the gangs coming for you, too. Yeah. Like, you know, in this case, bounty
shot
hunters.
Shot very but, classic yeah. Western.
Oh, one, every
Especially
episode.
When he, like, took off in the cart with the droid, and then it, like, stopped because they shot it. I was like, that's right. They always shoot the horse.
They always shoot the horse.
poor droid, man. It's just like, what?
I didn't ask for this.
Like, droids are, like, almost people in this universe. And it's just like, yeah, go drive. Like, all right,
I was surprised he got in the car because before he was like, no droids.
Yeah. Guys, I want to talk about two big takeaways from this episode. You see that he kills a bunch of these stormtroopers as he's rescuing Baby Yoda. He doesn't kill the scientist, but also old man, rich Imperial guy who's probably on the run, nowhere to be seen. Mm-hmm. So he's out there. What do we think about
Did
that?
Did he put the hit in? Who knows?
Yeah, I think he'll be the financial muscle for everybody coming after him. Is that he's going to be like, I want the baby and I want him dead.
Yeah.
So there you go. Like that's like he is like, you know, going back to the old Western, he is like the rich baron, robber baron, who's like, I send every bounty hunter you got mm-hmm. against him and get me my thing that I want.
Well, it's interesting you say that because that goes into my second big talking point. Carl Weathers gets shot. At this episode, you think, oh, well, bye-bye, Carl Weathers.
But classic Western style. He had something hidden
He had the Bible.
He had the Beskar. Yeah, I know. He had the unsmelted Beskar.
And you see him do it earlier. He's like, I'm rich, too. And as soon as it covered his heart, I was like, you motherfucker. Yeah. You're going to get shot there, and you're going to be safe.
If the Imperial guy put the hit out, then what is Carl? Is he the pimp here? Is he the one sending out all the bounty hunters?
I think Carl Weathers basically is the one who's going to direct people to him, and he's going to be involved in it, obviously, because he knows him. He knows how he works because he's worked for him, obviously, for it seems like a few years at least. So I think Carl Weathers will kind of be like the second to last boss, if you will, in this video.
Oh, I like that.
Whether or not you
the
like it.
The Goro to old Imperial Man Shang Tsung. So.
Ooh, another good reference.
You like that?
Yeah.
You like that?
Yeah, well done.
Matt's having a good day.
I know.
Bravo. I'm not going to go all the way to get the button, but
you're
yes,
fine.
Real claps.
Yeah, satisfying ends to every episode, I think. Like, the way the episodes always, like, end, you're just like, oh, that was great, but I want another.
Let's talk about, which, you know, he can't even call him a spoiler anymore. He's everywhere out on social media. Mm-hmm. Baby Yoda, you know, I feel like we talk about it every episode, but I think we need to as they go on. What is he? Who is he? Are we getting any kind of hints that this is just another member of his race, a clone, a reincarnation.
So I'm not going to say reincarnation, and I'm not going to say it's Yoda. Everybody calls it Baby Yoda because nobody knows what the race is. But they said he's 50 years old, so that means he was alive when Yoda was alive.
And it could be Yaddle's baby.
Yeah, I mean, or it could be that like Yoda's species reproduces asexually and Yoda laid an egg or some crap like that. I mean, there's still time for them to like kind of write. They can essentially write their own lore.
I'm wondering how he was taken care of for the last 50 years, if that makes any sense. Because it's like, I know right now he's ended up in hands, but was he just stolen from somewhere? Like, did the baby feed himself?
The Empire, my take on that is that the Empire could have already had him, and during the war with the Rebels, that whole thing, mm-hmm. you know, the whole thing.
Yeah, the whole thing.
All the Star Wars?
The war in the stars?
That the Empire lost hold of him, and now mm-hmm. even though they're on the run, they're at least trying to get him back. I'm going to take a really big deep cut here and say that I'm going to go along the lines of a clone. Because remember at the end of episode 3, Palpatine fights Yoda, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and Yoda gets beaten up, and mm-hmm. he claws at one of the things, and there's a good chance that left DNA, ooh. And Palpatine is ridiculously smart, and as we know, at least from the expanded universe, into cloning. What better way to get, like, the biggest Jedi Master of all time on your side, but to clone him and turn him to the dark side? I think it's a Yoda
That's
clone.
That's such a Sith thing to do.
It is. It's 100% a Sith thing to do. I think he's a clone.
Can I say the most tragic death in this episode was the pod that he was floating around in? I know. Just completely in ruins. Yeah. And I was just like, no more pod racing. Pod hovering? You're not going to give me that? He's a podling. A plus animation, though. Like, whoever's working on the Baby Yoda themselves, like, they're making so it good. So cute. And you're just like, I can't. Any scene he's in, but he's like half puppet, half not.
Oh, yeah, you see, like, because I remember one, I think we even somebody said it when we were watching. You see, like, the little hairs on his head when you see him from
yeah.
the back behind.
His little hairs, his little ear flipping.
And it's gray like Yoda's.
When the ship White lands like next Yoda's. To him, it's like.
Just saying. Mm-hmm. Just saying. Before we get into our next segment of the show, let's give our word or multiple words for this episode. Words to describe episode 3, Brittany.
Everything I've ever wanted.
Didn't you have your one word?
No, I didn't get to think of it. You didn't give me time. Because I did Yoda, Suka, and I wanted another word.
Okay, give me one. I got 10 seconds for you.
No.
Murder.
That's it, murder. There we go. That's what we're doing.
But there's not really, there's a lot of murdering.
There is a lot of, he comes back for him.
I'll take it. Murder. Matt.
So I'm just going to use Baby Yoda because of the ridiculously catchy song that somebody made.
After. It was so good.
Baby Yoda. Like, you can find it on YouTube. If you Google it, you're going to find it. It's some it's animated thing. And oh my, it's like 2 minutes long, and it is one of the most catchy goddamn things ever.
My two words for this episode because of the awesome rescue scene for Mandalore.
Yep. Yes.
Yep.
1,000%.
For Mandalore. That does it for our episode 3 review. Next week, as we go into December, we will have our review of chapter 4. We will be doing this all the way up to Rise of Skywalker. So you have that to look forward to. We are going to take a break. When we come back, I see the excitement on Matt's face. It's going to be Raiders of the Bargain Bin. That is next. Welcome back to the show, and well, we're here at Wade's Comic Madness, and I'm sighing a little bit because I'm watching this DVD menu of Matt Damon.
It's really dramatic.
And Matt, I will let you say it. It is the return of.
Oh God.
Dormammu, I've come to bargain.
The Raiders of the Bargain Bin.
Raiders of the Bargain Bin. And Brittany, you're here with us too.
I am here.
You are here.
And I'm excited. This movie sounds really amazing.
You picked this one out. So brief history real quick. The Great Wall was in our first ever pull list of when we did the first ever Permitted Minute, and it got voted out. But we circled back around to it, and it is time for Matt Damon in The Great Wall.
Matt Damon.
Matt Damon.
So we're getting ready here. The candy's ready. The beverages are ready. Brittany's going to go back upstairs in a few minutes and pop the popcorn.
Pop that corn.
And we're going to watch this, what is probably going to be a really bad movie. Guys, before we get into it, we have to look at the Rotten Tomatoes score, as always. And it's not looking very good, guys. The critic review score, 36%. The audience score, 42%. Ooh. Pretty concise. And Brittany, because you picked this movie out, take it away. What do you think we're in for?
I think you're in for over-the-top Chinese martial arts action, possibly fantasy. I don't even know. I don't remember the trailer. It was like over a year ago. Maybe there's a dragon. Who knows?
A dragon?
I don't know. At this point, it's not historically accurate.
If this
what?
Is
Matt Damon's
wait,
there.
What? It's not.
No, there's a white guy on the Great Wall.
Exactly.
If there's a dragon, I'm going to put it at full price because dragons make everything knows? Better. Matt,
crouching
what do you think?
Tiger, hidden Matt Damon.
Yes.
Part of me is expecting this movie to be like the Chinese. Oh, we've been fighting this enemy for generations. Oh, thank God a white guy's here to finally win the war for us.
Yeah. I think it's because it's a Chinese-made film and they wanted to get one main Hollywood actor to get everybody to see it.
Yeah.
Well, so for that, I allow it. But at first, I remember I was like, ooh, white guy, what are you doing?
Well, everyone initially, because they didn't know there was actually Chinese involvement with the production of this film, was like, what the hell is white guy, friendly face Matt Damon doing in a Great Wall of China movie?
You just wanted to be Scarlett Johansson for once.
There you go.
Oh!
Bam.
Ghost in the Shell.
Yeah, I got that reference. That was really good.
Yikes.
So we are going to have a live crowd here in a little bit. We at the last one we did was friend request for Bargain Bin Movie Night, and we took everybody's bargain bin meter score, so we'll have the aggregate of that as well. Matt, I didn't actually quite ask you yet. What do you think we're gonna get with Matt Damon in the Great Wall?
I mean, I'm just expecting a movie with, like, I'm looking at the menu screen right now of like those little clips that they showed during it, and I'm just expecting like some kind of fantasy action war epic type thing where lots of CG flaming arrows and stuff like that. And, oh, we have to fight this enemy, whatever it is, and blah, 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 blah.
I will say the production value, just from the DVD menu, this is a good way to maybe get an idea. The production value doesn't look half bad.
Yeah, but that's what they picked for the menu, though.
But will it be better than the Battle of Helm's Deep?
I mean,
I don't think so. Unless a dragon actually appears. That, I hope one
that's
does.
Still one of the most iconic and still holds up beautifully shot war scenes in fantasy ever.
Take him down, Legolas.
I'm looking at like people in like ornate, beautiful looking armor bungee jumping off the wall. So yeah, we're in for quite a ride here, I feel.
I feel like it's not going to be good, but it's going to be horrible.
Wait, was that Pedro Pascal?
So I was about to say.
I was like, yo, wait a minute.
Oberon's in this slash the Mandalorian. Yeah. He's the Mandalorian now. And Matt Damon, who I just saw in an excellent movie.
Like we all just noticed at the same moment, too. We've been watching this on a loop.
Matt Damon was in Ford vs. Ferrari and was absolutely fantastic. So
the other F word.
The
Ford,
other
Ferrari,
F word.
Fantastic. Fantastic Ford? Don't even. Don't.
Oh, God. No, God, please, no. 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 No.
Speaking of disappointing movies, we hope this isn't.
Exactly. So before we take our break and watch this train wreck or
no trains are involved.
I was trying to think of a pun about walls, and I can't. This movie is going to maybe hit a wall at some point. I'm trying here. I'm trying to get on your level.
To the window, to the wall.
All the females.
I was going to say, let's not finish the song.
Before we take our break and watch this movie, let's give, if we had to rate it right now, our bargain bin meter score based off just the DVD menu. Matt, we'll go with you first.
I mean, the production quality does look semi-decent, so I will say Walmart right now, just the kind of the average.
Brittany.
I will say, I feel like this might just be like low barrel Walmart.
Low barrel Walmart.
Or high barrel Walmart. Low barrel Target, that's what I meant to say.
Guys, I'm gonna make a very noble prediction here, and I was gonna say Best Buy, but I'm gonna go with Target so I don't completely disappoint myself. This actually has the potential to be not the worst bargain bin movie that we've watched.
Maybe it'll be as on target as the archers in this film.
Boom, and that's where we're gonna end before she could make any more puns.
You're welcome.
We're going to take a break. You're going to hear that awesome, nice elevator music. And when we come back, we are going to tear Matt Damon apart. We'll be back. Welcome back to the show, and we know Brittany's ready to go.
I just pictured the Mandalorian and Baby Yoda like in the elevator. Like, I'm still thinking about it because Pedro Pascal's in this movie too. So I was like, how cute would that be?
Everything is interconnected, like, but the like force.
9 degrees of Pedro Pascal.
But like a jazzy cantina song.
No, have you ever seen, I think it was in one of the Family Guy Star Wars specials, but they took like the Imperial March theme, made like an elevator when they're in the elevator. Like, yes. It's awesome. Oh, you totally get that. I need to get that.
Great segue. Guys, it is the return of Raiders of the Bargain Bin. We recorded that intro for you right before we watched the movie. We have now all seen the movie. And like I said at the beginning of the show, a little bit of decisiveness here, some different opinions.
Divisiveness?
Did I say decisiveness?
You said divisiveness.
Yeah, I meant divisiveness.
Decisive is not what we are right now.
No, we are not decisive. We are divisive. My bad.
We're all really hyper today. We all keep like fumbling on our words.
I had a latte at home and I had a latte here.
How dare you?
And he has latte to say.
That was good. Some of yours are just god awful, and that was fantastic.
That was a good one.
Thanks.
Guys, we saw Matt Damon and Pedro Pascal in
and Willem Dafoe. Let's
sorry, and
we
William.
Cannot forget him.
Honestly, your attempt at an accent there was better than Matt Damon's in the entire film.
The Great Wall, Chinese produced film. Their I think biggest budget for a movie made in China ever. What do we think? You know, we talked about it before we saw the movie. The critic score was 36%, audience 42%. Matt, where are you on your initial thoughts with The Great Wall?
So, I mean, I actually didn't loathe the movie. I truly didn't. I thought it was competently made. Whoever designed the costumes pretty much should get a raise.
Yes.
Because
yes,
like the Chinese costumes, like the different colored armors, which represented their different jobs and all that stuff like that. Awesome stuff.
Beautiful.
Like I love the hell out of all of it. I love the fact as well that it looked like they had a shit ton of extras that were all dressed up. Like not, they didn't just CG a massive army of people on the wall. It's like they actually had like these people marching, running up and down the wall and all that stuff like that. Good stuff. Yep. All around. However, this movie killed me with the dialogue.
And that's where I agree. Like I disagreed with that. Like Brittany mentioned the bad accent from Matt Damon, but other than that, like I didn't think the dialogue was anything awful. I actually really enjoyed the banter between Damon and Pedro Pascal. I thought they were both wonderful.
I mean, to me,
some of it was yucky.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
No, you're good. Go ahead.
No, like, yeah, I didn't, to me, it seemed like, all right, I need to look up who wrote this movie, because was it a Chinese person, an American? Because if it was a Chinese person, I give them some leeway because maybe, you know, English isn't their first language. And so they're just trying to be like, we'll just try and have some banter.
It was fine. It was good.
I think it looked like everybody who worked on this film had a lot of fun shooting it. Like,
yes,
all, like you said, all the extras and how they're not like CG'd in. Like, it reminded me kind of like Lord of the Rings in that way, where it's just like, you know, these extras have stories to tell, or they like really enjoyed being that armor. I want that armor.
It was literally so like cool. Going back to my childhood watching the Power Rangers all over again.
Like, and the color schemes, everything like really felt like traditional or classic like Asian fantasy films, like those really crazy ones. I loved it.
So if you guys are ready, since I pulled up the wiki page for this movie, so I'll give you the screenplay by and story by. So the screenplay was by Carlo Bernard, Doug Miro, and Tony Gilroy. The story is by Max Brooks, Edward Zwick, and Marshall Herskovitz. So not a single Chinese person, a bunch of white guys,
and a couple of Jews. And
as we would say in China, guai lo. That means wide-eyed.
Yeah. Brittany, your initial thoughts on The Great Wall.
It was nowhere as bad as it could have been.
Yes.
Or should have been. Like, seeing a trailer for this, I was just like, yikes. But watching it, it was really freaking fun. I had a good time because I have a martial arts background. I watched all these over-the-top Asian epic films. And this one was just, like, super fun. Like, it went from somehow meeting like traditional Asian epics in a certain way to also just making them wild and like modern. They're suddenly fighting aliens. I was like, this is great. And it was like, maybe the Great Wall would have been better if it was actually for this purpose instead of its actual purpose. So I just thought it was fun. I loved the colors, everything about it.
Part of the reason that I love doing Raiders of the Bargain Bin is because I love tearing these movies apart and destroying them and making fun of The Rock and Vin Diesel like a lot, because those seem to be a lot of the movies that we pick. No Rock or Vin Diesel this time. But I was pleasantly surprised. Like, Brittany, you said it was a lot of fun.
That is the word, pleasantly surprised.
Yes, it was a lot of fun, and I actually will say that I enjoyed the movie. Is it perfect? God, no. Is it a classic? God, no. Is it fun and like a really good action movie? Hell yes.
Did it have an awesome amount of women in the film too?
Yes.
I was like, whoa.
Unfortunately, though, they were kind of like
eight
used for like, you know, cows out to
pasture. They bungee jumped
but
into danger.
They were
danger.
Really badass.
They were really badass. And, you know, the spears they used and like a lot of the weapons in this movie was awesome.
Although it was kind of funny to me, though, when they go right before and they're getting ready and they walk out onto their post and they just throw the spear at them. It's like, come on, man. Just grab the spear and walk out with it. Like, why do you need to have it thrown to you?
But it's so classic over-the-top martial arts.
Yes, that's true.
Like, if you want to see a mixture of like Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, like there was less martial arts in this film, but still like that fantastical nature.
There's some like, you know, there was wire work in it. Yeah.
It was like hero colors, a little bit of like Crouching Tiger action, but I don't know, it was just goofy. I loved it.
It was goofy.
The dialogue
helped
a lot too.
Yeah.
I thought the dialogue was fine.
It was fun sometimes.
Also say that, like, I think you both have already said it, that the production value was fantastic. You know, all the stuff like marching up and down the wall, the costuming, the weapon design, the sets, they were all really, really good. Like, you could tell they spent a lot of money and didn't use a lot of CG. I will say, though, my biggest gripe of the movie, I think, Matt, one of your biggest gripes as well, it seems that's what they used the budget on, because for the big fight scene at the end where they're trying to kill the queen, like, that CG was...
Yeah, the CG ran out
abhorrent.
Of it.
Like, it was like, oh, yeah, we spent our budget on all the real stuff, so here's
and
some...
And, like, the initial fight.
Yeah.
With all the fireballs and the arrows, you were like, whoa, this is really cool, and then by the end, you're like, ooh.
Yeah, here's some shoddy CG of falling out of windows, and... what I really thought was cool, though, was when they're trying to launch the black powder at the queen, and they pull, I think you said it, or Matt said
I think the 300 move.
Yeah. I was like, oh, nice 300 move, guys.
It was the 300 move, and I was like, that was badass.
I liked all their tactics, and I like that even when you have those, like, Westerner main characters that popped in, which I'm fine with just because the Chinese, like, company was literally like, we want Matt Damon and some other people so people will watch this. Then I was like, okay. Different twist.
Yeah, it wasn't like they were whitewashing the movie.
They had different fighting styles, though. Like, Pedro Pascal's character, literally, it's stupid and ridiculous, but he does, like, straight-up bullfighting.
Yeah.
He's like,
because he's Spanish.
Exactly. So I was like, this is, it's goofy.
And Matt Damon does weird arrow shit because he's Irish. Apparently,
He says he's English, but yeah, like, literally, like, the wiki page says he's Irish. Like, I'm like, what?
Yeah. If he could have committed to the accent, or rather, whatever director was working on this would...
Direct him to
commit to a specific accent.
Let's,
I think
let's
it
see who
been
the director was.
Now
I'm
solid.
Curious about that as well. Directed by it was a Chinese director.
Yeah.
Zhang Yimou.
So maybe they couldn't always tell when he was doing the accent, like 100% on or not, because
he was either Matt Damon Matt Damonok
exactly.
Something.
Or as my brother called him when we were watching the movie together, he was like, what was it like? Damon of House Matt or something like that, because like it's inverted when you speak an Asian language where it's like your family comes first. But I was like, oh my god, I can't.
Would we say that this is the best bargain bin movie that we have watched so far?
It's the best one I've watched with you guys by far.
Yeah, it probably is, and that's kind of sad when you think about it.
It's a little
sad. Really sad.
And even when stuff was like over the top, it wasn't in the way that like Journey 2 was over the top, where like, Jesus, dear God. But it was kind of like, oh my God, this is ridiculous. Okay.
I mean, at least the movie in the very beginning, like the text like establishes about like, look, the Great Wall is like this long and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. It was built, you know, there's many different reasons why it was built, like in legends, like this is one of the legends. So right there, the movie's like, this ain't real. Just don't take this seriously.
Yeah. And I would say that was probably my biggest disappointment for the movie, because, you know, like, Chinese mythology is just, like, so deep in lore, and, like, these are aliens? Mm-hmm. Like, did it really need to be aliens?
But, like, at the same time, if they would have made them, like, demons or spirits, which happens, like, a lot.
I still think I would have preferred that.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, though, that if they had made them demons or spirits or something like that, that would have been a little like, what? So they just, they come out of the earth in this one place, yeah, and they, why don't they just come out in the capital and so on and so forth? Mm-hmm. Like, at least when they're aliens, like a meteorite fell to earth and it made the mountain green. So that's, there's a place they're coming from.
Yeah.
This so, literally easily could have been the plot for any Power Rangers. I just want to throw that out there. Like, I know you mentioned it, but like.
All that armor, man. This, you can tell. Here's the Red
Ranger.
Come on,
Saban.
Actually, I'm not going to lie. They basically kind of took the idea from a video, old video game on PlayStation called Resistance, where
I love Resistance. The
Tunguska event ended up falling to Earth, and it had aliens on it that end up going across the world. So, same premise, yeah, really.
I like that.
Those games were great because there's no happy ending.
Yeah.
And they didn't make any more. And it was just like,
not yet, they haven't.
I did like a lot of the dialogue for the Asian cast.
Yes.
I feel like that's where a lot of like the main story work went into. And also, it was culturally relevant and like made sense. It wasn't anything ridiculous. I like that they didn't speak English most of the time unless it was the translator woman speaking to them.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. William Dafoe's character, like you said to me before while watching it, literally did not need to be in that film except to give a reason why she could speak English. Like, he was ridiculous.
I was really not happy with William Dafoe in this movie.
Yeah. Is it William or Willem Dafoe?
Willem. Whatever. I call him William. I don't dare. I don't care.
Willem Dafoe.
William did not need to be in this movie.
No, like, I think I said before we recorded, like, a literal throwaway line.
Nothing, guys? William did not have to be in this movie? Dafoe?
Oh, that's worse than me. Oh. You could have said he's Dafoe of the movie because he was that bad.
Like as I said, a throwaway line of like, you know, like her speaking English to Matt Damon and be like, well, how do you speak English? She said, but then like, you know, traitors have come through our lands before.
Would have been better than
like, Willem and Dafoe. Willem Dafoe be like, oh, I've been here for 25 years. They haven't let me leave. And I just teach them English and Latin.
If we really want to dig deep and maybe tear this apart a little bit, his whole him being there like for 25 years, like there's no escape. There's no way out of here. And then, like, they escape.
Yeah.
Right? Like, it takes having one other guy with him to escape. I'm like,
I feel like he was there just to initially release them as like, oh, there's another white guy. He'll set us free.
Yeah. Like, you couldn't have done that 25 years ago?
Hey, the Mandalorian is on your side. You're getting free.
I did like his character. He was fun.
I did, too. He reminded me of Inigo Montoya a little bit.
Yeah.
Just a little bit. Some of his lines were very, like, Inigo Montoya.
Although he did say, like, one of those, like, groan-worthy lines when he's just like, I want to be the one that kills you to Matt Damon. I just wanted to be like,
oh, I liked that.
Come on. Because
it was sarcastic. It was good. He's like, I wish you would just let me out of here so I can kill you myself. Oh, man. He's like, I don't even know you anymore. I liked him.
I like that Matt Damon had to prove his archery skills by shooting a fucking ball out of the air.
It was cool, though.
And it was like definitely over the top, like what Chinese films would want. And I was like, this is amazing.
I'd have to watch that scene again, but I am pretty certain that he fires two arrows at one point and that does not appear in the final thing whatsoever. Because he goes like, boom, he fires the first arrow, which knocks the cup. And then he knocks two, and it looks like he lets both of them go at the same time. But in the shot,
one,
and then two, and then because he fires like another one after. I'd have to watch the scene again to be totally sure.
Physics.
Yeah. Whatever. He catches a ball out of the air and everybody's like, oh. I like the one general. My brother pointed out the yellow general. He's just kind of like shrugs. The rest of them are like in awe, like, oh my God.
Guys, as we always do for the bargain bin movies, we give our bargain bin meter score. We did have a little bit of a crew. We had our good friend Rob Migliaccio was there, and the ever expanding, not expanding Tomes family.
My cousin
your
Kevin
cousin
was
Kevin
there.
Was there.
One of the D&D guys also came downstairs.
Yes, one of the D&D guys.
That was awesome.
So we got three bargain bin meter scores from them, and it was a unanimous out of our system, which goes from the worst being garage sale up to dollar store, Walmart, Target, Best Buy being the best, and then full price being like the holy grail. All three unanimously, Target.
Nice. Mm.
Target.
That's very rare.
Yep. So we will go around and give our bargain bin meter score. Yeah, Brittany, since you picked the movie, we'll go with you.
I want to say it's Target also, because I was really blown away by the production value with the costumes. And I just thought it was a fun film. Like, if somebody else in the future is like, oh, I haven't seen this film, where like they throw it on TV and they're like, oh, let's just like watch this, I'd watch it again just because it's so like just goofy. And if they haven't seen it before, I wouldn't go out of my way to watch it myself again, even though I own it on DVD. But.
You are now the proud owner of the
group. I put it on the shelf with the rest of my martial arts epics. There so you go. I'm like, go, you go right in there. In my white protagonist section. I do have it. You joke.
Oh man.
Yeah. That's so good. There's my Jet Lis, my Bruce Lis, my Jackie Chans, Michelle Yeohs.
And then
in the far corner is my white protagonist in a somewhat martial arts film.
Eddie Walker, the Texas Ranger in there.
I hate that man.
Chuck Norris.
I hate Chuck Norris.
Eddie Steven
I hate
Seagal.
His memes. I hate him. Steven Seagal is just kind of like, why? But have I watched them all? Yes.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus.
So that's four targets. Matt, bargain bin movie score.
So I'm actually also going to go Target because all right. I mean,
I'm shocked by that.
No, I like, don't get me wrong. Like, I bashed the movie a lot while we were watching. A part of that is just because I like to be entertaining and I watched way too much Mystery Science Theater.
And I do want to go back and say real quick, I wouldn't be doing it justice if I did say that while we were watching, I didn't think that you were giving it a fair chance.
No, I certainly did. And don't get me wrong. Like, comparing this movie to The Last Witch Hunter, Friend Request.
Worst one we've watched
and some of the
would watch Journey 2 over that.
Everybody's face when they mention Friend Request. Like, even in my family, it's like a bad word now. When someone says Friend Request, they're like, oh God, not again.
Like, I mean, comparing, like, this movie is in a completely different league than those movies. Like, it actually, like, I was interested in what was happening.
Yeah.
I'm not going to sugarcoat it, is like, I loved the female lead. Like, she was
so good.
She was good. She was gorgeous. She was powerful. She was, like, you know, competent.
Everything you would want.
She wasn't like, oh, Matt Damon's here. Thank God. Yeah,
she was like telling him how much of a wimp and a coward he was.
Yeah. And then, and like at the end, she basically like, she's like sets him free and she's like, I'm going to hop on this like experimental hot air balloon that might burn down and go to the Capitol. Yeah. To like try and fight these things, so you do whatever the fuck
you
want
to
do, Matt.
You can fuck off to America or wherever you're from. Yeah,
like, I was so nervous that they were trying to establish some kind of like romance, and I think they were, but then she was like, "Nah, fuck you, get out of here."
And I like that he comes back and he's just like, "Trust," like that word they have to each other, and she's like, "Oh, you might have honor yet."
Yeah. Now leave before I put an arrow through your head.
Yeah. What do you think?
I would go with Best Buy.
What?
I am giving it Best Buy. I thought it was a good movie. I liked it. I enjoy it. I would buy a Blu-ray, you know, $5 copy of this movie.
They have
it.
It
definitely knew what it was, and it didn't try to be something it wasn't.
Well,
that's what I appreciated.
Well, and see, that's the thing. I didn't know if they knew what it was, and that's why I gave it Target at the beginning when we recorded the intro, and I'm changing it to Best Buy because it was a good movie. Mm-hmm. I am in the 42% of people that enjoyed it. Oh, I think we all enjoyed it.
Yeah. No, I enjoy, like, as I said, like, it is a semi, like, if you were to go through all the bargain bin movies we've watched and said, you're going to rewatch one of them, I'm going to be like, okay give me Great Wall. Please, for love of God, give me Great Wall.
I'll watch Great Wall to the end of time. I want to say, much like Midway, definitely watch this for the Asian cast.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Because it was like very good.
But I wouldn't watch Midway again, even for the Asian cast.
Oh, no, I wouldn't. Someone would have to pay me to watch Midway again. And I might fall asleep midway through.
It's too bad that we saw that in theaters and didn't wait to do that for Bargain Bin. Because that was basically like doing a Bargain Bin.
We didn't know.
The thing with Bargain Bin, though, is that sometimes it takes a while for certain movies to make it there. Like, I know you and I have had our eye on it, but the new Robin Hood with Taron Egerton.
Yes.
We've been waiting for that to hit the Bargain Bin.
Yes, that is going to be a good one.
We'll wait till it slowly creeps off the shelf in Walmart. Overnight and crawls in there.
Speaking of movies that belong in the bargain bin, Justice League. Let's get into our next segment, which is the whole controversy that's been, you know, taking Twitter by storm, which is the hashtag Release the Snyder Cut trending again, being supported by pretty much the entire cast now. You know, big names like now Gal Gadot is absolutely supporting it.
Yep, Batfleck.
Yep, Batfleck, Jason Momoa, and now, you know, Zack Snyder is basically like, we want to release it. Now, what are we missing out on, guys? Like, what do we think that, you know, there's a good movie here? Are we missing out on something? Why do you think that, you know, WB is so hesitant to release it when Snyder was the original director in the first place?
I don't even know why they're doing that or why they decided to change it up, unless it was somehow like darker than they thought would work with audiences. That's maybe my best guess. But at the same time, I was really looking forward to like Black Suit Superman. I was looking forward to that return of Superman that happened in the comics. And when it didn't happen in the movie, I was just like I saw the behind the scenes shots. Why did you have to reshoot
where
that?
Where did it go?
Yeah, where did it go? And that's what I wanted. That's what I paid money for. I thought I was going to see that. Not mustache removed Superman.
2 cents CG, right?
It's the hardest part to CG is the upper lip. And like, why did that need to happen?
I mean, like the thing is that I'm curious to see what we missed out on, so to speak, but I can't think that it's going to be this vastly improved quality, because when the issue is that when I think darker, especially with like Zack Snyder, I think of Batman shooting and killing people. And I'm just kind of like, oh, God, you're completely like missing the point of his character and what he's about and all that stuff like that. And to me, Joss Whedon is a competent director. Like the first Avengers movie was Joss Whedon. Like,
oh, yeah.
He directed it. So the guy knows how to make a solid movie.
Well, let's also not forget that like Buffy and Angel are both like classic series. They're pop culture
mainstays. Yeah. And Joss Whedon, you know, I'd say directed Avengers. And that's what I was kind of looking up on my phone here while you guys were talking, was some other movies he's directed. And he did do Age of Ultron, which was so-so. It was semi-decent.
He didn't want to come back for that, and I think he basically took the money for that.
But the thing is, though, is that like Age of Ultron was still enjoyable.
Yeah.
And so you're telling me that this guy who has shown the ability to make these big movies with all these superheroes coming together, that like this cut that is so amazing that it's going to be like an incredible experience? Like, I just don't believe it for 1 second. So I'm curious to see what the Snyder Cut has in it, but at the same time, I don't believe that it's going to be, you know, that it's going to be this amazing experience like some people think it will be.
You know, you guys are talking about, you know, things that we wanted to see in this movie and, you know, things that got reshot. You're saying, like, why did it need to be reshot? You know, and that Joss Whedon's a competent director. Where's the controversy here? But it seems like, you know, It wasn't so much Whedon. It seems that WB was like, Snyder's not really attached to this anymore. We want you to basically reshoot the entire film. It was something like 80 pages worth of script, you know, and that's not what he was originally brought on to do. Mm-hmm. Zack Snyder had released a whole statement saying the movie's complete. He's just doing some reshoots. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, it's still my movie. Obviously, that's not what happened, you know.
It's definitely WB deciding to change the image of the film or like whatever he did with it after he was gone off the project. So it must be a creative difference thing, which is why I kind of want to see the Snyder version, because it's like, what did he do that WB changed it? And then like, can we figure out why they changed it based on seeing that version?
Yeah.
I just want to know what his vision was or what it could have been had he unfortunately not had to leave the project.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat as Brittany. Just like, I'm curious. I'm not like one of the like, I demand to see the Snyder. Like, all right, if you release it, great. Like, I'll watch it, you know, just to see if it's any better. But I mean, and it wouldn't surprise me if it was to some degree better, because, you know, there's been many instances of pop culture media where a company has been like, we don't think this will do that well. And so they basically force changes on it. And then people find out what it was going to be. And we're like, this is awesome. I mean, look what happened. Look, Deadpool was almost entirely thrown up, you know, out the window because of like, there's no way this is going to be popular. People were like, this is awesome.
And the Deadpool movies are like some of my favorite superheroes.
They're absolutely fantastic.
Especially Deadpool 2. I'm like, this is amazing. I love it.
So, you know, I guess the biggest question is, you know, with the whole cast supporting it, and I don't think you could tell me that any of the cast are happy with the movie that came out, mm-mm, which is the reason that they want this Snyder Cut to be released. Do you think, because listen, I'm a Man of Steel sympathizer. I actually really enjoy that movie. I thought it was a great Superman story. Yeah, it's a little bit darker toned. I hated Batman vs. Superman. You know, Henry Cavill, and we're going to talk about him in a little bit, mm-hmm, said it best that it was a Batman movie and that he just happened to be in it. And mm-hmm, Zach did a really good job making a Batman movie. The question is, guys, is there a good version of Justice League out there if there's this much support for it?
I think the actors know what scenes they're in and they want to see. Like, I, as an actor, if I did these amazing scenes or, like, did certain scenes shot a certain way and then later on reshoots happened and then a certain version got released, I'm sure I still have the memory of what we actually filmed in my mind. So I'd want people to see, like, okay, but I really said this in that scene, or, like, it really, this happened and that's much cooler.
I mean, realistically, was, like, Jesse Eisenberg less of a crappy Lex Luthor in the Snyder Cut? I mean, as I said, I think it might be better, but do I think it would be good? That's a tough call, because what's the best movie Zack Snyder has done? Like
300.
Exactly. How old is that?
And
movie?
Maybe Man of Steel. Yeah. Like Man of Steel was.
Man of Steel was okay. Like I'm an apologist
Man of Steel
for the
made
movie.
Me cry.
Of course it did.
You know what?
God. I'm pretty sure we could like take.
I'm leaving. I'm out.
I'm pretty sure we could take a photo of a bagel on the desk, and that's gonna make Brittany cry at some point.
If it's an everything bagel, it might make me cry.
It's real sad.
A bagel is sad and hasn't been eaten.
Brittany, you mentioned Black Suit Superman. You know this is Black Suit Superman's a massive part of my childhood. Matt, I don't know if you had at least three action figures of him. Death of Superman,
mullet Superman,
his resurrection. This is something that was in the movie. It was shot. You have to think, guys. There is an 80-page script, and that translated to movie stuff that was filmed that does not involve. And I know this is going to sound funny, but I'm taking this seriously. Like that involves not having a CGI'd mustache off Superman, like where there's like a Superman that looks like Superman and not like a CG face. You know, there's a good version of Superman in this movie somewhere, and that's what I want to see.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I also think the fight scene between him and the other members of the Justice League when he comes back to life would make more sense if he's in the black suit and it shows that like when he comes back, he's obviously not himself rather than him just like randomly being shirtless and wearing jeans or something. Was he buried like that? It was so confusing.
I know somebody who reviewed the movie like pointed out something funny during that whole fight scene. They're like, oh, they're all about their secret identities, but during that fight scene, like it was like Clark. It's like, oh, I guess his name is Clark. So yeah, we got that down.
This news came out after I finished the outline here, but a former DC exec who still works for the company has kind of gone back a little bit on the notion that WB has no plans to release it. He said that if Zach wants to put the work in that needs to basically put the polish on, even though the CG is done, like you always have to, polish something for a full release. If he wants to put the work in to do it, then absolutely they'll release it. And one thing we didn't get to here yet, like it would be a fitting tribute for Snyder to have this movie released. Like, wouldn't it, the reason he had to leave in the first place, topic, it's very hard to hear. His daughter Autumn committed suicide. Mm. It's the whole reason he left the movie. What a better way to release a Snyder Cut and, release it straight to DVD or a portion of movie ticket sales go to, suicide prevention, charities, like things like that. I think there's an opportunity here.
No, absolutely. And that'd be cool as hell if they did that. But do I think that they would do that versus like, we're going to try and make some more money off of this movie, which didn't make as much as
well. I still think it would make money, but I if they want, it's my hope and dream that they would do something like that. That would, mean something.
I admire your optimism.
I know.
Yeah. I more so just want to see it just so I know for sure what was his vision. What could it have looked like?
Yeah.
And then I can finally decide like, oh, okay. I liked this. I like some shots in Justice League. I like certain aspects of it, but overall, I haven't gone back to watch it. I think since I saw it in the movie theaters, or at least since I saw it when it came out on DVD again.
I liked anything that involved Bruce kind of getting the team together. I liked his kind of interactions with Diana, because that they're friends at this point, and they're very much friends in the comics as well. But they're kind of butting heads about Clark and that
I didn't
whole thing.
Like how that movie. Didn't it come out right after Wonder Woman? Or right before?
No, it was after.
Right after Wonder Woman, because Wonder Woman was a really amazing film that explored her in depth. Yep. Like, not that it's the best film ever.
Well, and Whedon.
And then he went back and, like, undid parts of her character, which is my big problem with Joss Whedon. He, like, claims to be a feminist, but if you look at his work, he writes himself in all the time.
Yeah.
He's not that good. Like, I'm thankful he did Firefly and things like that, but if you really look, when he's on a project too long, I mean, look what he did with Age of Ultron. He kind of, like, destroyed Natasha's character. Like, he doesn't do well by his female characters, really. He does some things that make it feminist, but overall, you're like, you're just another, unfortunately, one of these nerd guys that does this, so.
Yeah. Guys, we were talking about Henry Cavill, Black Suit Superman, Mustache Gate, whatever you want to call it. Originally, there was the report that he quit Superman. Like, he was done as Superman, was never going to play the role again. Not the case. Obviously, he's about to start his journey as Geralt in The Witcher on Netflix. And
Geralt.
Whatever. I don't play the games.
Oh, no. We'll have to get it for him.
I know. I already know what my Christmas present is from Matt.
I might get you something different now. Just
you
to,
should.
As a screw you.
You should. Because I probably won't play it. Kidding.
How dare you.
So he's come out now and said that he has not quit playing Superman, that the cape is just in his closet. He has more stories to tell as Superman. And now we've seen that DC has the ability to make good superhero movies. Aquaman was a little bit cheesy, but was still really good. And Shazam was fantastic. Mm-hmm. So two really good movies. Birds of Prey looks really good. You know, can DC make a comeback and make a Superman movie of the same caliber we've seen in Shazam and Aquaman?
I personally would be like, the only way Henry Cavill makes an appearance, I feel, is if they do like a Crisis on Infinite Earth type thing, which obviously they're doing on the TV shows, because of the fact that, like, fair or not, the stink of Batman, Superman, and Justice League and all that, and to some people, Man of Steel, is on Henry Cavill's portrayal of Superman, and that's not his fault, unfortunately. Like, he works with what he's given. Like, if the writer says, like say this line, like, I poop out my butt, like, that's not Henry Cavill's fault, to, you know, if the writing is complete garbage.
Yeah.
So, I mean, as I said, and with Robert Pattinson coming on to play Batman, and it seems like they're kind of going with a younger Batman. If they do go back to Superman eventually, I feel they're going to go with a younger actor again.
I would like to see Henry Cavill come back, but I think it's looking less likely because of exactly what you said. It would be a little bit weird, right, to have Henry Cavill, if they decide to do a shared universe, interacting with now Robert Pattinson Batman, not Batfleck, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. Unless they are kind of just leaving Superman in his own world now. You know, that's kind of my thought on it.
Yeah, I think if DC could once again get their shit together and get some cohesive, like, scripts or good stories to go for. Like, there's so much, as we talk about over and over again, in the animated films. Like, there's so much there. Just take literally that script and just shoot it live at this point. Like, I don't know how else to tell you. Like, there's ways that you can't screw this up.
Well, the problem is they keep pulling from too many sources rather than focus, like Batman, Superman. All right, we'll do the Dark Knight Returns.
What are all
we'll
the best Batman stories? We'll do Doomsday. Let's do them all at once.
We'll do Doomsday just to, like.
Yeah.
And like, what is the most iconic Marvel story? The Infinity War.
Yeah.
10 years of films culminating in the Infinity War.
Like, yeah, they took their time and they planned.
Yep. Which DC obviously
DC rushed into it to try and keep up, but I was just like, oh, establish your characters, please. Make us like them. Make us care.
Like, I say it to this day, and I think it might have actually turned out to be a great film. Batman vs. Superman should have just been Batman.
Yeah.
It should have just been Batman. And then you establish Batfleck now. Henry Cavill should have had a Man of Steel 2, like Iron Man had an Iron Man 2 before there was even another, you know, Marvel movie released.
Mm-hmm. Well, because they made the very wise, quote-unquote, maneuver of killing Superman in literally his second freaking movie.
Yeah, that was like so
it means nothing to us, the audience. So.
And even the Justice, like, they weren't even a thing mm-hmm. yet, kind of. And it's like they didn't have that dynamic, that, like, friendship, that where it would be such a huge loss if Superman died, you know?
Yeah.
Like, how would it affect the league? It's in shambles now. What are they going to do without him? Like, it was just
piss poor.
Yeah, not good planning. Yeah. Too much rushing.
And I hate to say this because, you know, the Justice League is just a little bit whitewashed, but I hate the character of Cyborg. Like, I think he's a lame comic book character, and they didn't write him exactly. They didn't write him well in the first. I wish he wasn't.
They could have even based him off the Teen Titans, like, teenage version, like, of Cyborg.
Yeah,
it would have been great.
They could have replaced him with, like, John Stewart Green Lantern if they wanted to, like, add, you know, some racial diversiveness, like, put Green Lantern in there. Do something other than stupid Cyborg, in my opinion. I could, you know, even though these movies aren't that great, like, I love DC. Batman's, you know, my Batman hat is sitting over there. Like, I love Batman. I could talk about this all day.
DC fans are hardcore, too. So that's the thing. If they would finally just make these good films, we'll show up in droves and numbers.
Yep.
I mean, look what we did for Joker, which was an artisan Joker film. Like, if you give AMC us content, we will show up.
Yep.
Give us content.
Facts. That is going to do it for episode 40. When we come back, it'll be December, and December is Star Wars month. It's so exciting. And with that, we are going to be doing a lot of Star Wars content in December. Next week, we are going to be doing Mandalorian Chapter 4 review, and I cannot wait, guys, Knives Out.
Oh, Knives Out, yes.
Yeah, I'm curious to see it. Yeah, definitely.
Our Knives Out review. So we have that to look forward to. We'll be back with episode 41 next week. Have a good night.
You can find Everything is Permitted on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and YouTube. Everything is Permitted is produced by Rob Migliaccio, Nikki Vizi, and Geneva Stein-Shivers. Our executive producers are Michael Cox, Brittany Tomes and the Tomes family, and Julian Brown.